Rico Bella Productions and Tree Brothers Studio present These are a people with and around whom you can let your freak flag fly high and sing to the sky. Hello, I am Larry Harry Berry, and along with Angie-lo, Savage Neil, and of course the one and only Orange Pourage, we, a band of outliers, are the Wayward Consortium.
Everybody,
I'm all right. I'm doing great. I'm always good.
You're always good. I'm fantastic too, Angie-lo. Thanks for asking.
What about you, Orange Pourage?
I'm doing great. Thank you very much. Yes, I'm very much like Savage Neil, and very appreciative of your asking. Thank you for asking that, Angie-lo.
It's my pleasure. It's my pleasure as always. Welcome again to another episode of the Wayward Consortium, all you beautiful babies out there in podcast land. You got anything for us, Larry?
Actually, I do. So a few days ago, I'm delivering pizza, as I'm wont to do for money. You understand? I am the pizza man, and I do the best.
You do the best you can.
That's right, Savage. I do the best I can. And so the boss man takes the order, and it's always handwritten notes, you know what I'm saying? And handwritten's just garbage anyways. Anyhow, he gets the phone number wrong, and he writes down Wolford. Wolford Lane. That's W-O-L-F-O-R-D Lane, right? And so I'm going to Wolford Lane. And of course, the GPS, it doesn't recognize the street numbers or anything, but it takes me to Wolford Lane. It takes me to the street that I typed in the phone, you understand?
Yeah, I got you. I'm following. I'm reading. I'm keeping up with the pages and the words on the pages. Continue.
Okay, so I go to Wolford. The street number's not there. It's not on W-O-L-Ford, right? So I restart typing it, and I see a Walford. That's W-A-L-F-O-R-D. So I go to Walford, and again, the phone number is wrong. I can't reach the customer, and there's no point in me, you know, calling back.
Yeah, I was just about to say, why didn't you call the store back and talk to the manager, the boss man?
Well, there's no point. If he got the number wrong, that's just it. There's no way of getting in touch with a customer, you understand? Okay, so I go to Walford, right? And the street number's not there either. And there's no mailbox with them numbers on it. So then I find a Welford, and sure enough, there is within 5 miles of each other, there's a Walford, and a Welford. And of course, it wound up being the third one, the last one was the house, and the guy, he was like, say, man, what's up? I've been waiting a while. And I was like, man, I didn't have your phone number. It got it wrong. And my boss man wrote W-O. He didn't write W-E. And the guy's like, oh, man, you know, so it was crazy, man. It was crazy. But the short end of the stick, the happy ending to the story is, man was happy, gave me a $5 tip. He said, well, I can't take it out on you, can I? And I said, nope, I'll take that $5, though. Appreciate you, sir. You know what I'm saying? So, that's all. It's just another woe in the pizza delivery service industry. There's always something like that.
There's always something going on funny and kooky in the pizza delivery service industry. I've noticed that. The years you've spent being a pizza man and a pizza delivery driver, you've come back with some crazy little stories.
Yes, Larry, I do believe that Savage is onto something here. You should write like a little manifesto.
Oh, I've already been thinking about it, you know, the do's and don'ts of the pizza delivery man. But not only that, but the do's and don'ts of the customer. You understand? There's a whole unwritten etiquette between the pizza man and the pizza man customer, right? That the customer is totally unaware of most of the time. You know, we're talking about dogs that bite. We're talking about lights that don't work, ring doorbells that don't work, when they cover up the street numbers on the mailboxes with decorations. questions, you know, when they don't answer their phone after they've already given you your credit card number. You know what I'm saying? It's like, man, we strangers. You know you got some food coming on his way. You need to pick up the phone. So, yeah, I've been thinking about writing a little manifesto for some time now.
Well, okay, so great pizza story. Let's get on to, like, what's going on with Dangerously Orange and the Stranger Things 2 review? Does anybody know?
I don't know. I was very much looking forward to it because, as you know, at the end of last episode of the Wayward Consortium, we left a little bit early so we could watch the last couple of episodes so that we would be, you know, all caught up and, you know, up to speed with the Dangerously Orange Stranger Things 2 review. And sure enough, what happened? They bonked on it. They absolutely bonked on it. Matt and Joe of Dangerously Orange and Tree Brothers Studio, they were supposed to get...
Come on, Savage, get it out there.
They were supposed to get it up, you know, in the last couple of days, and it didn't happen yet. But I hear tell it's coming soon. Don't worry, don't fret, it's coming soon. In the meantime, the analysis from South China Morning Post's very own Wang Zhangwei, he says China's success is tied to its relationship with the U.S., despite what you may read. And it's an interesting article. It has 925 shares, you know. And whatchamacallit, it's basically talking about, you know, the recent trip that the Trump and Melania entourage made over to China on their little Asia trip. And talks about how the two-day jaunt in China ended with a dinner inside the Forbidden City. And it was the first time that a visiting U.S. president has ever been given the honor. And there's an interesting point that the author of this article brings up. He says, quote, another interesting detail, right, which received less attention from international media was the historical significance of the venue where they had the tea, the Bayonne Building, also known as the Hall of Embodied Treasures, in the southwestern corner of the Forbidden City. It is the only Western-style building there. It was used to store antiques, but now serves as an exhibition hall of the museum's history. You see, it was built in 1915 with $200,000 from the Boxer Indemnity War reparations from the U.S. government, and it helped preserve the Forbidden City as a museum. You see, so for over 100 years, you know, the U.S. government, there's evidence of the U.S. government trying to keep parts of the Chinese history alive and preserved, you know, and that's pretty cool, I guess. It remains unclear if President Xi briefed Trump over this fascinating piece of history, but the chosen venue serves as a powerful metaphor for the long and complex relationship in which both countries can work together for the better good, and that's what the article is all about. He talks about how, you know, there's going to be a lot of backlash and for Trump, who's weakened at home amidst all the crazy Russian scandaling and the faltering agenda and whatnot, but it also says, you know, but don't underestimate this relationship between China and the United States. For one, at the very end, he talks about the future relationship between the two countries will remain hopeful so long as their top leaders remain engaged in the kind of personal diplomacy witnessed last week, and it comes on the heels of China just promoting the Belt and Road Initiative to expand its economic and political influence in Asia and beyond. But also at the same time, the Trump administration is now preaching a new strategic slogan of free and open Indo-Pacific, giving rise to speculation that the U.S. is seeking to form alliances with Japan and India and Australia in order to contain China, right? So there's going to be competition, as the article explains. If you want to check it out, it was just published on November 11th of this year, 2017, just a day or so ago. On the South China Morning Post. But it talks about, even though there's competition between the nations, there's no reason why they can't all still work together in order to make each other successful. And I think that's a good thing. What do you have, Angie?
Well, even one, this is from the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, even one drink per day can increase your risk of cancer, study wards.
Jesus Christ, everything increases the risk of cancer. God damn it, living life increases your chance of cancer. How about that?
Very well put, Larry.
Thank you, OP. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Orange Pourage.
Stop it. Stop it. Stop it.
You know you love it, OP. So yeah, even one drink per day can increase your risk of cancer and blah, blah, blah. Of course, it doubles, triples, quadruples if you smoke and drink. So of course, we're all fucked. Listen to his voice. You can tell he smokes like what? How many packs of Reds do you smoke a day?
Well, I don't think that applies to me, you know? Hell, I should have been dead long time ago.
This is true. This is absolutely true. How you're still alive is still a goddamn miracle. Modern science.
That's me. I'm a miracle.
Okay, stop singing, Savage.
Well, okay, I won't.
What do we got here? This is from, this was just published a couple days ago, too, on November 9th of 2017. This is from Penn State. Penn State University did a research on mushrooms, and not the magic kind.
Oh, I was about to ask, the magic kind?
Nope, not the magic kind. I know Savage loves him some psilocybin.
Yes, I do. It's really great for depression.
We were somewhere around Barstow, on the edge of the desert, when the drugs began to take hold.
It really is.
Okay, so they're talking about regular mushrooms, you know, mushrooms that you can eat and not feel psychotropic effects from. But they're talking about how mushrooms are full, chock full of antioxidants that may have anti-aging potential. And it's a good article, too. It's on the PennStateUniversity.edu website. And they're talking about that mushrooms have high amounts of now I'm gonna say these antioxidant names, but you could damn sure bet that I'm getting it all wrong. Here we go. Dun, 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 dun. Ergothioneine and glutathione. Is that all right?
I think you did all right.
It sounded good to me. You know, I wouldn't know. It sounded great to me.
Okay, well, they're both very important antioxidants, says Robert Bielman. He's a professor emeritus of food science and director of the Penn State Center for Plant and Mushroom Products for Health. He added, that's a hell of a title. How do you fit that on your business card?
I don't think he would have a business card.
I don't either. He added that the researchers also found that the amounts of the two compounds varied greatly between mushroom species. He said, quote, what we found is that, without a doubt, mushrooms are highest dietary source of these two antioxidants taken together, and that some types are really packed with both of them. He said that when the body uses food to produce energy, it also causes oxidative stress because some free radicals are produced. Free radicals are...
What are they?
Are oxygen atoms with unpaired electrons that cause damage to cells, proteins, and even DNA as the highly reactive atoms travel through the body seeking to pair up with other electrons, right? So replenishing antioxidants in the body then may very well help against this oxidative stress. And they talk about the free radical theory of aging and all this good stuff and blah, 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 and how it can also, you know, antioxidants can also help with diseases, not only with aging, but like cancer and coronary heart disease and Alzheimer's. You know, mushrooms are magical and more sense than one. According to the researchers who report the findings in a recent issue of Food Chemistry, the amounts of these two, let's say it again all together now, shall we?
No, I don't want to say it with you.
Okay, ergothioneine and glutathione, something like that. These two antioxidants vary by species, but with the porcini species, which is a wild variety, they are the highest among the 13 species tested. They said that they found the porcini mushroom has the highest by far of any of these paired antioxidants, of any of the ones that they tested. And the species is really popular in Italy, by the way, where searching for it has become a national pastime. How about that? Okay, so the more common mushroom types, like the white button, also had less of the antioxidants, but still had higher amounts of them than other foods. So basically, mushrooms are really good for you. Eat a bunch of them. I'll bet the shiitake's in there somewhere. I'll bet the oyster is in there somewhere too.
What about my favorite? You know what my favorite is?
The portobello.
Yeah, the portobello. Is it mentioned in there?
No, but surely it was one of the ones. They tested 13. Now there's thousands, I believe, species of mushrooms. But, you know, I'm sure they tested portobello, Savage. You know, maybe they didn't.
Oh, but I like it. Just tell me they did. Tell me portobellos are great for me.
Well, everybody knows portobellos are great for you. Just continue eating them. You're doing all right. You should be dead by now. It might even be because of the portobello mushrooms that you always eat, lathered in butter and all kinds of chives and breadcrumb goodness. They might be saving your life and keeping you alive right now, Savage.
I like to think that. I really do. I like to think that a lot. Okay, so check this out. This is from Yahoo. A Walmart shopper who broke his hip picking out a watermelon. It's a food themed show, ladies and gentlemen and beautiful babies out there in podcast land. Picking out a watermelon, he's awarded $7.5 million from Walmart for breaking his hip, for picking up a goddamn watermelon. I wish to God I had thought of this shit. This is crazy. An Alabama jury has decided that the Army veteran, he was an Army veteran. Happy Veterans Day, by the way. It was yesterday, right?
Yes, that is absolutely correct. If you know a veteran, thank that veteran. If you don't know a veteran, then thank a veteran in your heart and your soul and in your mind and send and cast out the positive wavelengths all the way, the vibrations, send them out there, because it's because of a veteran that we are here today, speaking English and enjoying the life of luxury that we live.
You call this a life of luxury? Oh, you're a funny guy, Larry. You're a funny motherfucker.
Yes, he is. Yes, he's fun. Oh, I mean, I wouldn't know. I've known, actually, the richest of all luxuries before. I dined with Cleopatra in her fanciest rooms. And, you know, it was great and all, but nothing beats this shed. You know what I'm saying? This is a great shed. And we are very blessed to be alive and speaking English in this very shed. In this backyard, in fact.
Yeah, a shed, yeah. Actually, we might not be that blessed, but a lot of America is because of our soldiers, and thank you very much. Happy Veterans Day. Okay, so back to it, Savage. Get your toes off Angie. No, I don't mind it this time. I don't. Angie, you're a freak. We're all freaks. Okay, that's enough.
Oh, come on. Give me my toe back. Come on, take it back.
Okay.
Did you press mute? Stop pressing mute. Can you press mute? Please, is it on?
Yeah, it's on. So anyway, the guy's an Army vet. Let's see here. Let's go back to the page here. He's an Army vet. He's picking out a watermelon at a Walmart store. And you know, he was 59 in June 2015. You know, I was thinking he's like an old man breaking his hip. He's only 59.
59 years old and he breaks his hip picking up a watermelon in Phoenix City, Alabama? Hey, we know Phoenix City.
Yeah, we do. We used to go through Phoenix City on our way down to Panama City, the Panhandle, Florida. Yeah, that was really good stuff. Anyway, so as Walker, that was his name, he was retired Sergeant Henry Walker, as he reached for the watermelon, his foot got stuck in the side of a wooden pallet under the display. That led to him falling and shattering his hip, according to court documents described by the Washington Post. How about that? And this last Wednesday, the jury awarded Walker $2.5 million in compensatory damages and $5 million in punitive damages. How about that? How about that? Walmart has called those amounts excessive in light of the facts and said it plans to appeal the decision. And you know, I know Walmart's mega rich and all, but come on, man. The slip and fall lawyers have ruined this country, have they not?
I've seen it, I've bared witness it, and yes, I would absolutely agree with you.
If I were to slip and fall, I would probably be banging on the door of a slip and fall lawyer. I'm with you, Larry.
Oh, you sorry sons of bitches. Anyways, you're all so very funny. Angie-lo, what do you have for us?
Well, you think you know what you have for me? I think I know what I have for you.
I didn't say any such thing.
Well, scratch that, never mind. Now, a missed connection. This is a guy talking to a girl. To whom it may concern is the title. He writes, "Call me. I have something for you before I leave for my birthday weekend. I would give it to your dad, but you know how that is. And I don't have your number anymore, so I can't call. So as not to be vague, our birthdays are a day apart. Your middle initial is A. And your kid has two last names. There you go, missed connection. I hope you find each other.
Okay. My name is Orange Pourage, and this is Orange Poe-age.
Well, that's quite the book you got there. How many pages are you gonna flip through, Opie?
Just never you mind. I'm finding my page.
What is this, anyway?
Yeah, what is this? Orange Pourage. It's me, Orange Pourage, reading quotes and words written by the late, great, and amazing man known as Edgar Allan Poe, if you want to know.
Well, inquiring minds did want to know. How many pages are in that book?
It's a big book. Hold on. Okay, this is this week's Orange Pourage. Are you ready?
Of course we're ready.
Go for it.
Yes, please.
Those who dream by day are cognizant of many things which escape those who dream only by night.
Wow, how about that? Ladies and gentlemen and beautiful babies out there in podcast land, that is how we're going to end it. Actually, we're going to end it on this fun note. On this day in 1965, the Velvet Underground performed their very first concert at a high school dance in Summit, New Jersey. Contact us on Facebook at Tree Brothers Studio or hit up thrillofcontingency.com. On behalf of we, a band of outliers, many thanks for taking the time to listen to this episode of The Wayward Consortium.
That's the head of another curly head boy. Just another toy.